Can you hear me? We will start this session on geometric and structural preserving discretizations. I will share this session with Professor Alessandro Bravetti, but I will present the two first speakers and then Alessandro Bravetti will continue the presentations. So our first speaker is Manuel Lain from the Institute for Mathematical Sciences in Madrid, and the title of his talk is The Helmholtz Principle and Bacconomi Dynamics, and I think that this is a previously recorded talk.
This talk is entitled The Helmholtz Principle and Bacconomi Dynamics, and it is based on joint work with Manuel de León and Miguel Muñoz de Canda. The talk will be divided in three sections. The first one will be an introduction where I explain what contact manifolds and Hamiltonian vector field is, and I will be doing special emphasis in the Lagrangian formalism, which will be very important afterwards. Then the main part of this talk will be discussion of the Helmholtz principle with economic constraints, and last of all, we will be dealing with the Helmholtz optimal control problem and how it relates to the Helmholtz principle with Bacconomi constraints. Okay. For the introduction, first we will explain what a contact manifold is. A contact manifold is just a non-dimensional manifold and a one form, such that if you take the Wetz product of the one form with its differential to the nth exterior power, then you get a volume form. And that is a form that does not vanish at any point of the manifold. And in a contact manifold, we can define a rep vector field, which is just a vector field fulfilling these two properties. There is only one. It is one when it, once it's constructed with the one form, and it is on the kernel of its differential. So, in every contact manifold, there are local Darboux coordinates around any point. These coordinates are Qi, Pi, and Z, such that the rep vector field and the contact form take this coordinate expression. An example of a manifold that has a natural contact structure is a cotangent bundle times the real line, the extended cotangent bundle. And the one form is just defined as this, as the differential of the real coordinate, the R coordinate on this product, minus the pullback of the Liouville one form of the cotangent bundle. And it has this expression in bundle coordinates. Okay. So once we have a contact manifold and a function defined on it, which is the Hamiltonian, we will call it the Hamiltonian function, we can construct its Hamiltonian vector field. Its Hamiltonian vector field is just defined by these two equations. The first one regarding the derivative of the one of the contact form, and the second one it's just that once you contract it with the one form, you get minus the Hamiltonian function. You can see that this vector field is similar to Hamilton's equations. Indeed, this first term is just like the first term of the Hamilton's equation. This second term contains this extra term over here, which is the momenta times the derivative of the Hamiltonian with respect to Z. This is not present on Hamilton's equation, and this takes account of dissipative behavior of mechanical systems, for example. And this last term, which is regarding this set variable, which does not occur on the usual Hamilton's equations, and this represents this set will represent the action itself, as we will see now. A big difference with Hamilton's equations and the symplectic Hamiltonian systems is that here the energy is not conserved, but it dissipates as a rate of minus the the red vector field applied to the Hamiltonian, which is just the partial derivative with respect to the set component. Okay. Now we will introduce the Lagrangian formalism. The Lagrangian formalism take place on this extended tangent bundle, which has no natural contact structure, but we can create one given a function L. If you have this function, it will be called the Lagrangian. You can define this form over here. It's the differential of the set of the R coordinate, which is a global coordinate, minus the partial derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to the velocities times this dqi. Okay, and this is a contact form whenever this Lagrangian is regular. By this we mean that this matrix, the Hessian matrix of the Lagrangian with respect to the velocities, is non-degenerate. Okay, from the Lagrangian we can define the energy, and the energy has just this expression over here, where this delta is the Liouville vector field, which is just the velocity times the partial derivative with respect to the velocity. Okay, from these elements we can create the, we can construct the Hamiltonian vector field of this energy function with respect to the one form that we have created from the Lagrangian. And this vector field will be called the Herlot vector field of this Lagrangian. It is a second order differential equations, meaning that the integral curves of the Herlot vector field has satisfy the, a second order differential equation in the position and velocity components, and it is first order on this set variable. And indeed, these second order equations are called Herlot equations, which are over here. They are a generalization of the Euler-Lagrange equations, which has this this extra term, which also can take account of dissipation of some phenomena that cannot be modeled with the Euler-Lagrange equations. And the time derivative of this set function has to be the Lagrangian. Again, we can now see that this set can be interpreted as the action. Some topics that I will not be covering on contact Lagrangian systems are, well, in the case that the Lagrangian is not regular, instead of a contact system, we have something slightly weaker, which is called a pre-contact system. But it can be analyzed using a constraint algorithm that me and Manuel de León have developed in an article in 2019. Also, there is a theory of discrete contact systems and variational integrators, which is very useful to analyze this system numerically. And it has developed by, well, by Simoes, Edith, Martin de Diego, Manuel de León, and me in 2020. But maybe the first article regarding this topic is by Vermeer, Bravetti, and Serio in 2019. And they also have a follow-up article in 2020. And we also have generalizations of Noether's theorem. In this context, the interesting thing is that symmetries do not correspond to conserved quantities, but to something that we have called dissipated quantities that decay at the same rate as the energy. Okay, now we will end this section on the on the Lagrangian formalism by introducing the Herlot variational principle, which is a variational principle providing the Herlot equation. Okay, this is a principle in which the Lagrangian depends on the action. So it is you instead you need to do, solve an ODE to define the action instead of a definite integral. We'll consider the space of curves on Q with fixed boundary conditions, Q1 and Q0, and we will also fix set 0, which is a real number. Now we will define the action. For each curve on our space of curves, we will define a function, set sub Q, depending of these curves, which is the solution of this Cauchy problem. The time derivative of this, which we think of as the action, is the Lagrangian, And we need to have an initial condition, which will be this set zero that we have already fixed. And then we can define the action as the difference in the values of this set sub q function at the boundary points, which by the fundamental theorem of calculus is just the integral of the time derivative of this set sub q function. And by the ODE is just the integral of the Lagrangian. So it is easy to see that this is a generalization of the Euler-Lagrange variational principle. Okay, and the theorem we have is that a path q of t it's a critical point of this action functional if and only if the path, the time derivative of its set function, is a solution of the Hilbert equations. Okay. Now we will enter the core section of this talk, which is the Hilbert principle with Bagonomic constraints. Bagonomic constraints are given by a submanifold of the tangent bundle, and we restrict the admissible curves to lie on to be tangent to this submanifold. Okay, but the thing is that this is a hard thing to do and to interpret. With the in the way that we have introduced the Hilbert principle, which is as an implicit principle. So our first step is to interpret this same principle as an explicit principle with an explicit integral of the Lagrangian, but in a bigger space and with constraints. That this is exactly what we are going to do. Okay, we will consider now a space of curves that now goes on q times r. Okay, and it has boundary conditions on the curve on q, on the manifold q, and just an initial condition for the r. Okay, now we define the submanifold n of this tangent bundle of q times r as the point that satisfy that the set velocity equals to the Lagrangian. Okay. And we restrict our space of paths to the paths that which are contained on this manifold n at every period of time. Okay. Now we define the action the same way as before, but now on the whole space as the final value of set minus the initial value. Okay. And then we have that this path Q set, a path which is on the restricted space, is a critical point of the action, but restricted to the admissible variations, if and only if it's a solution of Hilbert's equation. Okay. Now that we have this interpretation of the Hilbert principle, we can just add more constraints on our submanifold, and we will see the equations that we get. Okay, so we will now consider a general codimension k plus 1 submanifold of the tangent bundle of q times r. And we will only assume that this manifold is transverse to the dot set direction. Okay, since, well, n can be locally described by constraint functions, okay, it is locally the zero set of those functions ranging from 0 to k. And since it is transverse to the dot set direction, we can always write the zeroth constraint at dot set minus a function, which will be the Lagrangian of the other variables. Okay, and we define again the action just as before, as the endpoint of set minus the initial point. Okay, and if we use infinite dimensional version of Lagrange multipliers theorem, we can prove that the critical point of the action regarding to restricted to the curves which are tangent to this manifold n, and these critical points correspond to the solutions of these equations over here, which are the Euler-Lagrange equations for this lambda a and times this the constraints, and the solutions must also vanish the constraints. Okay, but we can operate with this a bit. We can define for the indices which are from ranging from 1 to k. We can define these new constraints by substituting the z dot by the Lagrangian. We can define these new multipliers that we get by dividing the odd multipliers by the zero multiplier. And we can define this extended Lagrangian, which is our initial Lagrangian minus the new multipliers times the new constraints. Then the previous equations are converted to the Hilbert equations with Pachonomic constraints, which are just like the Hilbert equations for this extended Lagrangian, plus this condition that the curve must satisfy the constraints. Okay, and the theorem we have is that a path on this restricted space is a critical point of the action restricted to the space of admissible curves if and only if there exist multipliers, these functions mu a of t, such that q q dot and z is a solution of the Hilbert equation with Pachonomic constraints. And well, another way to get these equations is to consider the Hilbert equations of this extended Lagrangian, where here we think of the multipliers as variables, okay? But this Lagrangian is singular, but we can use our constraint algorithm to work with it. Last of all, we will be dealing with the Hilbert optimal control problem, and we will see how it's related to the problem that we have just been studying. Okay. This problem was introduced by Manuel de León, me, and Miguel Muñoz de Canda in 2020, and it is a generalization of the usual optimal control problems, but in this case the cost is not given by a definite integral but by an ODE. Okay, let's explain that. We will be working on the control bundle, which is just this fiber bundle over Q times R with local coordinate xi, which are the configuration variables, ua, which are the controls, and z, that is the action. And we will define a function on this fiber bundle, which will be the cost function, and we will also define the control equation x. Okay. And the problem is to find the curves from a closed interval to this control bundle, which can be split locally on three parts: the part on the configuration space Q, the part on the controls, and the part on the action. Okay. We will be looking for the curves that satisfy the following conditions. First is the endpoint conditions on the configuration part. It needs to have fixed endpoints, and we need to have an initial value for the set part of the curve. Okay. We will also ask Q to be an integral curve of the control equation, meaning that this is satisfied. And last of all, well, the part on the action has to satisfy the differential equation dot z equals the cost function. Okay, so and last, we will be looking for curves that have maximal value of the endpoint of z among all curves satisfying all the other three conditions. Okay, if you think about it, this is just a particular case of the Hilbert Pachonomic problem. Indeed, if we pick as constraints the control equations and as the Lagrangian the cost function, then the action of the Hilbert action of this system is precisely the endpoint value of the set component. So the equations of motion obtained through this principle, they coincide with the necessary conditions for the solutions of the control problem. We have obtained these equations, which are these are the equations of the control of the control problem indirectly through the Pontryagin maximum principle, but adding extra variables and then simplifying the equations again. And this is a more direct route that also allow us to see what's the link with the Herlot's problem and with contact dynamics. And it can be very useful for further research, for example, on other theorems or on discrete integrators. Okay, thank you very much. This was the talk, and this was the reference I have been referring to in this presentation. Okay.
Thank you very much, Manuel. Are there some questions from the room?
Or infinite dimensional symmetric groups. Can you hear?
Did you understand?
Manuel, can you hear the?
This is a question of Yvette Cosman-Farsbach on the second theorem of the second Noether theorem. Do you have application of second Noether theorem in your model?
Well, we have some theorems related to relating symmetries and conserved quantities. We have many versions of them, some which are for symmetries which come from the base space, and also for symmetries which act on the whole phase space. But I don't think we have an analog of Noether's second theorem. We have some generalizations of Noether's theorem, but not. I don't think maybe. I mean, the article. It's if you read the article, the theorems are very hard, easy to spot. So maybe it's.
You consider the question already.
Okay.
Thank you.
Consider the question already.
Okay.
Thank you very much. There is a question from Marcelo Seri. Do you have some specific control problems in mind that are naturally studied using these formulas?
We have some examples. Actually, as we said, if you have this kind of control problem, you can add more variables and you convert it into a usual control problem, but you lose some of the structure of the problem, and you don't it you cannot find all the symmetries the problem have. So we do have some examples, maybe like some control problems in thermodynamics where you want to maximize the entropy, for example. I think that example is in our paper on the control optimal control problem. So yeah, the answer is yes.
Are there more questions from the room?
No.
No. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. One last question, Manuel. One could discretize this Bakunomic equation. And so apply the result to control problems.
We can do that, but not directly, because these equations are singular, and the methods we have work only with regular Lagrangians. But in principle, I think it could be done.
Okay. Thank you very much, and thanks again to the speaker. And we will pass to the next speaker. Is I think it's Denis Matignon, maybe, or Ghislaine Heng, I don't know, but
Okay, it's a video by Ghislain Heine.
Ah, by Ghislain, okay. So it's Ghislain Heine from the Université de Toulouse, and the title is Structure Preserving Discretization of a Couple Heat Wave Systems as Interconnected Port Hamiltonian Systems. So please launch.